is a 15-year-old girl in possession of a Hong Kong independence banner, or anyone for that matter, a threat to the national security of China simply for possessing such a banner?
We feel very sad that some youths and teenagers have violated the law. We really don't want to see such cases, but unfortunately, in the last year, many youths and teenagers violated the law.
But this law is quite vague in terms of the definition of these crimes. And again, we can look at the first round of arrests. These are people who were in possession of signs and banners. Those kinds of things would be allowed in the U.S. under freedom of speech.
Actually, the police would not make charges just based on a single speech. It must be based on many other factors, such as the displayed banners or specific speeches made. These are only primary evidence, and police will need to continue to investigate for evidence to assess if there might be certain organizations, any planning, or any other actions.
I'd like you to respond to this quote from the U.S. Secretary of State Mike Pompeo. Beijing's paranoia and fear of its own people's aspirations have led it to eviscerate the very foundation of the territory's success, turning one country, two systems into one country, one system.
If China really wants to impose one country, one system, it doesn't have to do so much work. The reason why we have a law to protect national safety now is because we want to continue one country, two systems. If the safety of one country is under threat, without one country, how can there be two systems?
But given that this law allows for things like secret trials without the media present and just an announcement at the end of how it turned out, potentially no bail for suspects. How can international businesses feel confident to continue operating here if they are unsure how they're going to be affected?
Because laws about national security are more strenuous, and I think foreign investors would consider the stability of a society as very important. Only a stable society will allow the economy to grow and allow investment opportunities.
Should people expect the police to be looking much more closely at social media accounts?
I trust that law enforcement agencies will be very careful in tackling these cases. We hope to protect our long-standing freedom of the press in Hong Kong society, but we also don't want it to be used by someone to undermine social stability.
Somebody transiting through Hong Kong at the international airport could theoretically be arrested under this law.
I cannot foresee that such a situation may arise. Rather, we can see a case where a Chinese national was detained when they transited through Canada. Right now, I cannot see that in Hong Kong unless someone intentionally violates the relevant law.
Hong Kong lawmakers have been told that this law is not retroactive. Does that mean that whatever people posted before July 1st, 2020 would not be used as evidence against them?
There is no retrospective period stipulated in the law. I just want to say, after the law comes into effect, if you continue to violate it, of course you will be prosecuted, but all the actions that you previously did might also be used as evidence.
Hong Kong's final governor, Chris Patten, on July 1st, 1997, he famously said, "Now Hong Kong people are to run Hong Kong." You were the only Hong Kong person in the room in Beijing when this national security law was unanimously passed. How are Hong Kong people running Hong Kong?
The national security law will not undermine Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong. The saying, "Hong Kong people ruling Hong Kong," is followed by a high degree of autonomy. This high degree of autonomy is written in the basic law, so it is not fair for you to read it out of context. The national security law will protect Hong Kong people from the harm caused by terrorist activities. We hope that Hong Kong will not be used as an anti-China base for succession or subversion of state power.